We're starting with first bill is SB 2730 related to Anahola Hawaiian Homes Association. We have DHHL in support.
We have an actual in support.
Okay. Kauai County Council Member Ida Kalamura support. Pua Kukalo Hawaiian Homes Community Association support. Ho'omana Pono LLC, I know who that is.
Yeah.
Support?
No.
Oh, wait, I'm sorry, opposition.
Opposition.
Opposition. Did you want to testify?
Yeah.
Go, yeah, please, go for it.
Yeah, aloha. My name is Demond Connor, Ho'omana Pono Manager. And the reason why, like, first of all, I'd like to let you know that as a Kanaka Maoli, we got to support each other. However, with the Anahola Association, they have some problems up there dealing with their ability to manage their funds or to even follow the contracts of the law. And that's, if you're talking about asking for taxpayer dollars to fund what they like do, I believe that I just recently got the documentation through the Uniform Information Practices Act regarding the Kumu Camp that was also under the control of the Anahola Homestead Association. And I believe that DHHL had pulled the funding for them because of the mismanagement and not following by the contract for Kumu Camp. So, you know, if you're talking about, you know, spending more tax, throwing taxpayer money to something that an organization that is incapable of following by contracts, is mismanaging their funds, then I think you should think twice about doing that over here, because you're just going to continue to give money to people that just don't know how to manage their funds or to follow by contracts, you know. And we're going to be dealing with an issue of contracts later on in another bill. So I just ask that you guys take note and maybe ask DHHL about what the status of Kumu Camp is. I think that should be a relevant conversation, whether or not you guys should decide of giving taxpayer dollars to that. Aloha.
Thank you very much, Damon. Next, we have Senator Hwn Affairs Committee in opposition. And these individuals are all in support. Derek Kimura, Donna Aviao, Marion Kapuniai, and Vince Dodge. Is there anyone else that would like to testify on this measure? Okay. Move on, then we'll move on to SB 2762. Oh, yes, I'm sorry. Yes, Uncle Joe.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Joe Tassel, former Commissioner of Hawaiian Homes. At my last meeting on Kauai, I did, and, you know, after listening to what Damon had to say, I'm going to change my thing. I was for, now I'm neither for nor against. And the reason is because at my last meeting in Anahola, I experienced what Demar was talking about, meaning that there's a lot of hakaka going on. There's a lot of, and my suggestion to the people, Anahola was known for hukilau. A long time ago, Anahola was known for hukilau. And at the table, five different presentations were made. And in that five presentations, there was a lot of huki huki, not huki lau, huki huki, not huki like, huki huki. So my suggestion to the people from Anahola was, go back to the beach. Take the lau out and huki lau. Otherwise, it's dissension amongst the people in Anahola is going to stop them from moving forward. And that's what needs to be happening in our entire Hawaiian community. Get too much hakaka. Get too much huki huki. Yeah. And what's happening right now in the month of February is only but one way of bringing our people together. Even though there is those for and those against. But if we sit down and look forward, we might be able to address in the future, the very near future. But my suggestion to the people of Anahola was hukilike, aole, hukihuki, hukilike kako, mahalo nui.
Thank you very much, Uncle Joe. Is there anyone else that wants to testify on SB 2730? Any questions? Seeing none, we're going to move on to SB 2762 relating to the King Kamehameha Celebration Commission. And first up, we have Association of Hawaiian Civic Clubs in support. Next, we have Elmer Ka'ai, also in support. Is there anyone else who wants to testify on SB 2762? No, this is not really questions we can ask. Okay, next, SB 2763. This is also related to the King Kamehameha Celebration Commission. First up, Association of Hawaiian City Clubs in support. Waimanalo Hawaiian Homes Association support. Lebo Mikan in support, and Elmer Ka'ai with comments. Anyone else want to testify on SB 2763? Seeing none, move on then. Another third King Kamehameha Celebration Commission Bill 2806. First up, we have Royal Order of Kamehameha in support, Association of Hawaiian Civic Clubs support, Renette Carrera and Elmer Ka'ai also in support. Is there anyone else here to testify on SB 2806? Okay, seeing none, we're going to move on then.
Chair.
Oh, yes.
Carrie and she from Guardian Cemetery.
Yes.
I apologize. You sent testimony in late this morning.
Okay.
We don't have a copy, and we're in support of the bill.
Okay.
Available for questions. I can meet with the committee afterwards to ensure that the testimony is submitted.
And are you supporting all three or just the last one?
Just the last one.
Just the last one. Okay.
Thank you.
Very good. Thank you. Any questions?
For Dags. So my understanding is that part of the reason that the King Kamehameha Celebration is in the state that it's in is that it's attached to Dags, and you guys have discretion over whether or not to fund them, right? Is that how it was set up?
Actually, the situation is the King Kamehameha Celebration Commission funding is only from their trust account, which is from grants and donations, and it also affects both the salaries of the staff that they have as well as holding of any events.
So basically the trust account is pretty depleted, right?
It is depleted.
Okay. So part of it was, I'm just trying to think back, the original assumption was that they would raise their own monies for the celebration.
Yes. That's what is in the current law.
Okay. Okay, I just needed that clarification. So what this is trying to do is say that we'll fund it from general funds. The salaries is one bill. Another bill is asking for an audit. Another one is asking for, allows the membership of the King Kamehameha Commission to the chair to establish an advisory body.
Yes, and the bill that we're supporting does that as well as also provide some criteria for organizations to help select members to the commission for, and basically it's to try and also balance the commission's membership with people that have some administrative skills.
Okay. And, I'm sorry, I'm just coming into my computers somewhere in the building with all of the testimony in the bill itself. So does Senate Bill 2806, and I'm sorry I haven't been able to read the whole bill, I'm just reading the summary. Does it change that provision of the statute that says, or does any of these bills allow for, I just answered my own question, it does, authorizes use of general funds. My question was going to be, how can we get other funds there, but one bill does that. So I just answered my own question, so thank you.
Okay, we're going to move on then to SB 2946 related to Indigenous Hawaiian Architecture. We have Department of Planning and Permitting opposition, Department of Agriculture opposition,
department stands on his testimony.
Okay, testimony for that one, please.
Ho'oponopono in support.
Stand on my testimony in support.
And Sylvia Cabral in support. Is anyone else here to testify in SB 2946?
I will.
Oh, thank you.
Aloha, committee chair and vice chair. Ovau kapua kili ikua kamai. I stand in support of these two bills regarding Indigenous Hawaiian architecture, SB 2946 and 3059. Excuse me, I don't have my glasses if I've got the wrong numbers.
No, it's
but Hawaiian architecture has been here long before what we are in today. And it withstood the environmental effects of nature and of man. So I think that we need to support more native type projects, especially regarding our architecture. Although technology and time has shown a lot of room for improvement, I see that our native, our kupuna way of doing things was a proper and adequate way of doing it. So I do support these two bills. Mahalo.
Thank you so much, Kapua. Is there anyone else that wants to testify on SB 2946? Let's see. I think maybe Uncle Joe, and then we'll take the next two.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Good afternoon. You know, I was very concerned about something that came over the television back in October, I believe, when we experienced that rainy season and brown water was taking over Waikiki. It was a tourist that was being interviewed by the news station, and she could not believe what she was looking at. What she said, whatever happened to paradise? I'm sure she had come here before. I'm sure she had visited Waikiki when the architecture was not like what it is today. We are losing the reason why people come to Hawaii as a result of tall buildings, urban sprawl, and highways, and now a railway. We're really losing our reason why people are coming to Hawaii. As a tour escort, and I was touring with Kupuna Haole through the Rhodes Scholar program and the Elder Hostel program. Many of the people that I escorted around Maui and Kauai always ask me the same question. What happened to paradise? Where's the aloha that I came to when I first came to Hawaii? We got to look at our architecture and bring it back. Our kupuna knew how to live in total harmony with God, with man, and within the universe. This is what we need to go back with. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Mr. Lemo, do you want to come forward?
And then I just wanted the record to chair, vice chair, that you did submit testimony on this.
Oh, did you? Okay.
What time did you submit it?
I think it was submitted several days ago.
Several days ago.
Yeah. We got for 3059, and are you opposition of both? I know you're opposition of 3059.
Actually, I'm going to wait until you call the bill.
Okay. Sorry, I know it's confusing because they're the same, but yeah, they're slightly different. This one's, Indigenous Agriculture on Ag Land. Was that Larry back there? No, I'm sorry, I can't see. Oh, no, I'm blind. Come forward. Yep, come forward.
Thank you.
Sure.
Yeah.
I'm going to let them speak. They're more eloquent than I am.
Okay, it's fine. I'm Nalani Tukuafu. This is Dr. Kalawai Amor, and this is Kumupulani Sanensi. We're indigenous architects of Ho.
Right.
Anyway, we just we looked at the bill, and we, of course, we love building hale. It's our lifestyle. And we just had some concerns regarding the code. If it has been adopted into the Honolulu City and County Code, and if revisions need to be made for the architecture to be residential.
I'm taking a picture of her taking a picture.
Yeah.
Great to see you. So when we post it on Facebook, you know, we have that.
Great to see you. Okay, yeah, DPP is not here. But that's what they're saying, their testimony, that they already adopted in 2012 a new article in the building code to Indigenous Hawaiian architecture. But my understanding after meeting with DPP is that it doesn't accommodate living structures, though, to live in. I think that all they have in there is for non-residential structures, but that's my understanding.
That would be true. I mean, Kumupulani wrote the code, so
yes,
we know
so it's
that
great,
part.
But it's for non-residential, from what I think.
However, non-residential, we adopted it on Maui as non-residential, but you could sleep in it, but you couldn't have the electric and the water. That's it, but you could sleep in it.
Right, so we're for the bills, both bills, but we would want an expansion on the code itself, because you can outfit a hale with things that aren't going to overheat and burn on your hale. And you can put some basic plumbing in some in hale structures, so we're pro the two bills.
Great,
but your issue is at the county level, and you have to talk to each county to talk about the changes that you want.
So yes, and yes, and then
those are our concerns.
Those are the other things.
What about the
although you, like some of the wording of the bill had it so that if structures were approved, it superseded some of the city and county if it was on state land. Is that is that the case?
That's your other bill.
Possibly. That might be the next bill.
Yeah.
Because that's the frustration, I think, of what the people that requested this bill is, that even though it's technically not illegal, there's nothing to allow it to happen.
Right.
You know, and so I think, you know, if you folks have model building codes that we could give to the cities and the counties, that might help them so that they would be able to put it in their regulations, to enable people to actually use what they can, you know, to be able to build it.
Yeah, one of our main concerns is safety, making sure that when we build a hale and we've created a process to teach individuals how to build hale safely, and we have a whole certification process as part of that process, and making sure that individuals aren't just going out to build hale, but then they do it unsafely, is one of those.
Yes. Okay. Very good.
Anything else for that? Uncle Joe and sister was saying over there, you know, it is actually a practice that is in action, and bringing it back through this bill would be a great step forward.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And as you know, Senator English was... when he was in Maui County, he's the one that introduced that.
Yes, yes.
Thank you. How many certified hale builders are there?
We had from the first class on Maui through through Maui Community College. We had about eight already, and some of them.
How many altogether yet that are certified? Not from the first, but all together.
Yeah, we are right now about six. We have this class right now that's going on to certify more.
This is part of the problem, and why some of the bills have come up, is that when I first did the bills, Francis, what I anticipated was having a number of certified builders. And Frank, I'll be very frank, you need to graduate more people.
We need to
certify them, because we do not have enough people that can do this. The Attorney General is asking us questions about the certification and others. And, you know, you need to allow others to be certified and to go on their own and build.
Yeah,
we are right now in that process.
From 1999?
Yeah.
But one every two years, one every 5 years?
The problem is the decertified people are not going forward. I'm getting stuck with doing it. They're not going forward and building the hollies.
The issue has been that we live in a modern world and that holly building is not something you really gain monetarily from. And so in order to be a holly builder, you have to dedicate every day.
It's your lifestyle.
Mm-hmm. And it doesn't pay. So that means that individuals have to. Uncle can do it because he's retired. Mm-hmm. The rest of us can't do it 8 hours a day. We have to dedicate two or three or weekends. So that's
the problem that we face, though, is that, we don't have the builders, the certified builders, which I envision would have been done through your program. And the original vision was to have lots of people certified. The practice is always difficult, and so
any day now, they're going to be certified as soon as they get the certificates.
Well, that's the promise of these two bills. Is you actually, like any apprenticeship, you need people to have time in. So the more holly projects there are, the more people have time in and have hours under their belt. I mean, it's really a profession. So like any other profession, you need hours in on different facets of the build, and then you reach a point where you go through the certification process itself. So these two bills actually expand the possibility for us multiplying the number of people who then get certified.
And actually, in the last 3 years, I think we've made strides in that goal to perpetuate a new generation of master holly builders. We've created a halau, and we have 40 members, and these 40 members dedicate hours upon hours of time every year toward that goal. So we have a more formalized process than we did 20 years ago.
God, it was 20 years ago. Thank you. So, I guess the point is that we really need whatever it takes to get people certified, because we do have a lot of legal questions coming up from attorney generals, from the different counties, about basically the lack of certified builders. In other words, for us in the state, we have to make sure that there's a multiple. That's how we have a procurement process. If there's only one person that can build, it forces prices up. It forces a monopoly on ideas and a monopoly on holly building. That's not what we want. What we want is a diversity of it. And we want many different people building.
As of right now, we have almost one certified holly builder on every island. And that was my purpose to form this halau. And they have four people. So each Lima has five people in. So we've gotten them all technically trained, and they just have to pass a few more protocols. So. And the Palapala, of course.
And what's of the eight that you have, what's the ratio of men to women?
Well, there's me.
With all women in her game.
But we have about
the certified ones, the ones that the eight that are, you said there's eight, right?
She's going to be certified here shortly, as soon as the WCC puts out the certificates.
Who are the certified holly builders presently on Maui?
Malia, Mahea. Chuck Warner, he's the inspector, he's not building. There's a list, but they're not building, you know what I mean?
So it's like about two women and the rest men?
Mm-hmm. Three women.
Three women, yeah. And the rest men? Okay. Just because, okay. I want to try to figure out who and why, yeah.
And we have more women in training right now.
We have a lot more women in training now.
Okay, because I can tell you that, earlier the chair talked to me about, finding a way to to fast-track certification, and so what would be helpful to us, I know that, Miley was looking at this earlier this year, was, what is the criteria that's needed, and maybe give us, because you said you've got it down to how many hours, what needs to be put in. We can take a look at that and help to get more people, to kickstart this, right? 20 years later, we need to get more certified builders. So if we can help you guys get that, so tell us what your criteria, off of this, after this. Great. Tell us what it is, and we'll see what we can do to help.
Okay.
Mahalo.
Thank you. I have some questions for Department of Agriculture. If I'm reading your testimony correct, it sounds like one of your main objections is that you want the bill to specify that we're talking about farm dwellings for ag workers.
Yeah, we don't oppose indigenous architectural structures. For both bills, our concern is that if the structure is tied to farm dwellings for farm workers or tied connected to a farming operation in ag land and it meets code, we have no problem. But if it's just giving an exception that it can be built anywhere and the dwelling or the structure is not connected to farming or for farm worker housing, then, you know, we oppose it.
Okay. So if we were to amend the bill to make sure that we're talking specifically about farm worker housing, then that would be less objectionable to you.
If the dwelling or the hale is in agricultural district, okay, as long as it is accessory to agriculture. So, you know, whether it's for the farmer or if it provides farm worker housing.
Okay.
Okay.
Oh, yeah. Okay. Okay.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And is anybody from DPP here? Okay. Okay. Is anyone else that wanted to testify on SB 2946? Okay. Yes.
Good afternoon, Madam Chair. Mr. Vice Chair, my name is Jamie Rodriguez. Standing as an individual in support of both bills 2946 and 3059. Just a couple comments and why I support this bill. It opens up an avenue for indigenous health and decolonization of the indigenous natives of Hawaii. And I can see that even with the passing of these bills, it might be a long road to realization. However, it would help to bring up health practices, social practices, and collective community avenues that the people are able to build upon programs, build upon the health of the natives. And this is just the beginning to something that could be very fruitful. So stand in support. No written testimony. Mahalo.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay. Oh, yes. Hello.
Hello.
State your name for the record, too.
My name is Garnett Clark. For SB 2946 for Hawaiian architecture, I think it's great that we have our own people, you know, supporting Hawaiian architecture. However, on agricultural lands for farm workers, I oppose that. I like the architecture, but I oppose for the farm workers. If you're saying agricultural lands, you can take, for instance, Kunia farmlands. We can have a hale put up there, and I'm not sure if you understand what's going on in Kunia farmlands, where they're building so-called dwellings, but it's been coming out in the news that they actually have temples, pretty nice houses up there, but they're calling it farm dwellings. And it was specifically for farming. So for the Hawaiian architecture, I support it, but as a farm dwelling or farm structure on agricultural land, I think you need to look into it a little deeper. Okay. And I oppose that part.
Thank you. Okay. Okay, we're going to move on then, unless no one else on this bill, to SB 3059. This is also related to indigenous architecture, and this is talking about designating public and private lands, not limited to ag land. It's a slightly different take on it. So first we have Attorney General with comments.
Good afternoon, Chair Shimabukuro, Vice Chair English, Craig Iha, Deputy Attorney General. We just want to point out several areas in the bill that are unclear. So there's no definition of indigenous architecture, and there also is no criteria for what constitutes a person with expertise in indigenous architecture. We also note that
you heard earlier discussion, right?
Yes. Yeah. You know, we also note that the exemptions are rather broad in Section 2B, and you know, could be interpreted to exempt the indigenous architecture from environmental, health and safety, consumer protection, you know, other kinds of laws that are designed to safeguard the public. And there's also, it's also unclear as to the relationship between sections 2A and 2B of the bill. It appears that the exemptions in 2B are intended to apply only in areas that are designated under 2A, but it's not entirely clear.
Okay.
So we just recommend that the commission consider clarifying these issues.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Next, we have DLNR in opposition. DLNR, did you want to?
Yeah. DLNR stands on its written testimony.
Thank you. Department of Planning and Permitting, opposition. Department of Agriculture, opposition.
It's done on our testimony.
Ho'oponopono LLC, support.
Okay.
Carolyn Wynn Hildebrand, comments? Anyone else want to testify on SB 3059? Good? Okay, come forward. Thank you.
Hi, Kalavaya Morgan. I'm just being sent by the Hui to say testifying in support of, and also we wanted to clarify that that we wanted the structures to be built by actual certified Hale builders. Process to be more clarified.
Okay, very good.
Yeah.
Would you be able to provide a definition, like what the AG was saying?
We have it already.
Yeah, it is actually
in
the
section.
Just didn't refer.
It is actually in the codes.
Oh, okay.
It, actually, in a definition of indigenous architectures in the codes as
the
well.
The building code for the.
Yeah, the building code for all four of the counties.
Okay.
I believe that when we did the bill a few years ago, Miley, we defined it somewhere. It's
somewhere.
Just we didn't reference it in this,
yeah.
So we just have to do some research.
Okay, got it.
Okay.
Very
thank
good.
You.
Thank you. Anyone else wish to testify on SB 3059?
I don't have a comment.
Yes.
My name is Michael Daly. I'm an artist and a videographer, an independent filmmaker. I'm following homeless issues and Hawaiian independence issues. I'm not familiar with the bill, but I'm very excited about what I hear about Hawaiian architecture. It's an asset in every way to the archipelago and the people and the culture. I'm just interested to know and to put forward the idea that it should be open to multicultural input so that the certified architects are not only just female but represent a full cross-section of the community without discrimination. People that of the land, not necessarily Kanaka Maoli, but want to support the Hawaiian culture and the Hawaiian traditions and immerse themselves into that practice, just as they are hula dancers and speak the native language and go into classes in all of the Hawaiian pursuits and traditions. And the other thing that I want to say is that these dwellings and meeting places, facilities that are made using traditional Hawaiian architecture should be predominantly geared toward those who are displaced and maybe disadvantaged people. And I refer to President Clinton's 1993 bill, what's known as the Apology Bill or Public Law 103-150, that states that that the Hawaiian Kingdom was never directly relinquished, and that the government, the USA at every level, and the Church of the United Church of Christ, have a responsibility to repair the damage that was done in creating socioeconomic and health issues amongst Native Hawaiian people. But of course, it goes well beyond that. It goes to Pacific Island people. And so there's an epidemic of homelessness in Hawaii. And since there's a need for shelter in an emergency way, that lands can be opened up for the homeless and those who have been displaced.
Thank you very much.
So, Mr. Daly, I think you've misinterpreted what we talked about earlier. Your first point that I think you've got wrong is that it's not mostly female. It's quite the opposite. It's mostly male that are builders. So there's no discrimination based on that. Secondly, the indigenous architecture is open to all. And it's not based on anything that you alluded to in your previous speech to us, because you said that you want less discrimination in this. I don't think that there is any. So I wanted to be very clear on the record that I think perhaps, Mr. Daly, you've misinterpreted what
you
said.
All right. Well, I'd like to clarify as well that I don't think I was inferring any discrimination.
No, you said it.
I did. I'll look at my...
It wasn't an inference. It was a parlance.
Really? Oh, then I apologize for that.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We have late testimony from Paul Kahui.
One more.
Okay. Oh, yes. Yes, there he is. Yes.
Not yet to leave.
Come for... Oh, okay. Okay. Then we'll have... Yeah, and he come also after.
Thank you for taking me on such short notice. My name is Bo Kahui. I'm a chairman of the Hawaiian Affairs Committee for the Villages of Laiupua. I also serve as the executive director for Laiupua 2020 as a 501c3 beneficiary corpus to which we serve our community. I have submitted my testimony. I stand in full support of the measure related to Senate Bill 3029. I think it's House Bill 1934. But I want to just add any amount of support, whether it's underfunding based upon the judge's ruling of $28 million or something north of that, will certainly support.
Oh, wait, we're on indigenous architecture.
Oh,
I'm sorry. I thought this was for... I'm sorry, it's a different bill. Okay. I'm sorry. Sorry. Well, we'll call you back for the next last bill.
Okay. I gotta catch my flight home.
Oh, do you? Okay.
So we'll call you first. Sorry. Right away.
Thank you. Anyone else?
Yeah,
okay. Oh, yes, in the back.
Aloha. Chair Shimagabukuro and Vice Chair English, my name is Homilani Shadell. And actually, I didn't intend to say anything about these two bills at all. That isn't why I'm here. I'm actually waiting for 3029. But in listening to what's been presented and the questions, I just kind of want to point out that I didn't recognize him until he sat here and spoke, but Uncle Francis actually was on site teaching the Nakua Palihua in Kalailoa, helping Uncle Shad build the hale there. And if you haven't seen it, you should go and look at it. It's a representation of our culture. And to point out to you, Senator English, I realize that 20 years seems like a long time. And as far as the numbers of certified hale builders, I remember just before I left these islands, because my husband was in the Marine Corps and we had to leave here, our language was going to be lost. It is now here. We have more children, more adults speaking our language, but it took time. Our halaus have grown. The Marimonak used to only take 2 hours. It takes five now. And so what I'm referring to is that the process that it takes to bring back our culture may be slow, but it is steady. So whether it's 20 or 10 or 5, what we need are master builders who, like our ancestors, pass down that training. That is how our ancestors survived. Each family was responsible. Their kuleana was to learn one thing and learn it well so that they could teach the next generation. And I would just ask that this committee keep that in mind as far as the context, and I don't mean to maha'oi kalamaya'u, but I'm sitting in that chair and my na'au is just going and it says you got to get up and you have to say something. So I just want to remind this committee that halau building is a very sacred thing to do, and not anyone can do it. More than that, not anyone should do it. So I would ask you to keep that in mind and not look for the numbers.
Actually, Homilani, I'm going to stop you there.
Because, okay.
You know, my point is this. 8 certified builders in 20 years is not acceptable. Because in order for this to move ahead, we have one certification program in Hawaii. And that's why I asked them to certify more people, get it moving. Because we need to do exactly what you said. Well, of the 8, I'm presuming one of them is one that we awarded the certification posthumously. So, you know, the problem becomes we only have 7 living if that's the number that we have. You're correct that we have to allow for time, but also it's an academic certification that we do. And we need to get that certification moving. There's a problem because they've not graduated enough people. And so they have to get on to make people certified, and that would help more indigenous architecture move in Hawaii.
So in terms of what you're speaking about, was there a number determined at that time that within 20 years you will have 20 people?
No, when I originally drafted this ordinance in Maui County and put this together, the idea was to have as many people certified. But I think we all can agree that 8 in 20 years is not enough.
So it's more the number that you're looking for and not so much the cultural background. And
that's what the certification is. And by the way, I think you're misinterpreting the Hale building. You know, I know people that grew up in Hale, old Hawaiians when I was a kid in Hana. And, you know, I actually did a number of documentaries with them on how they built it. Everyone built house.
I understand that, but you're talking about...
But you just said only certain people, not everyone should. Actually, the way the Hawaiians did it and the way the Polynesians and the Pacific Islanders do it is everybody knows how to build. Everyone has a kuleana and how to do it. Some of the kids go out and pick the things that are needed. Other people know how to do the ties. Other people know how to put it together, but everyone is involved. And what you just said is that not everyone should be building. I think that the cultural practice is that everyone should.
And that I would agree, and I'll take my comment back on that. But what I'm asking you to consider is that this is part of our culture, and that don't look at it just from the aspect of having the numbers. Try to look at it as something being culture and something that needs to grow. And you're right. Yes, the children did go out and look for the pohaku. And there are those who had to clean the grass and to make sure that it was bundled correctly. There are many different steps, but usually there was one person who watched how the work was being done. Precisely. And is that what you're talking about as far
that's
as...
That's the certified building.
Okay.
So in the code,
and that was what I was referring to.
In the code, that when we set up the Maui County Code was the first, and then the other islands, and then the statewide. When we set it up, we have to have a certification process. And so what we did was we have a certification process, a very good one, I might add.
Okay.
That works. It's just that we need more people graduating from it. And we need more people that are certified to be that person you're talking about, to supervise and make sure that everything is done. I'm going to use a very Western term here, to the universal labs certifications, the stress tests that are needed for structures. That's what the kumu, or that's what the certified builders are ensuring, is that it's meeting those structural tests that we have to do to certify the hale. So I think we're saying the same thing, because we need more of that one person that can oversee to build the hale.
Okay.
And right now we only have 8 that are legally certified to do that. So, you know, everybody's involved, but the one person has to supervise it.
Right, and that's pretty much who I was speaking about. But again, thank you for the opportunity
Mahalo.
To share.
Thank you.
Mahalo.
Thanks, Ms. Shadell. Uncle Joe?
Thank you again, Madam Chair. I'm enjoying this conversation. The builder comes from your island, Senesi. And I work with Senesi. Hale o Ho'oponopono in Kona. We built our halau. And it was in Senesi. It was Madeiras. Today, 40 years later, just last year, we had a celebration because Keoa Canoe Club, Honaunau, applied for a grant from the ANA, received the grant to rebuild our halau. And that gentleman who will be rebuilding is sitting in this audience. I love the conversation because it has to do with Pu'uhonua also. And that's one of the things that we're trying to introduce with Pu'uhonua, going back to the culture. Like, for instance, 2 Christmas parades, Waimanalo. Who's walking in the parade? Nainoa Thompson, navigator. This last year, Nainoa stops and we talked for a while. I told Nainoa, he asked me, are you still on the commission? I said, no, but I'm working toward Pu'uhonua. Oh, Uncle Joe, anything I can help, let me know. And I told Nainoa right then and there, I'm going to put them on a canoe. If they want to go on a canoe, I'm going to put them on a canoe. And Nainoa said, you got it. So what you're saying, Senator, is so true, that from one can come many. And all it takes is one more, and we've moved 100%. And that too take one more each, and we've moved another 100%. So you're right. And I love the conversation because oftentimes I took my tour, you know where, to the halau in Hana. We sat with Senesi and he explained to the Kupuna Haole what the Hawaiian people did a long time ago. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Okay. Actually, I have a quick question, I think, for the, I don't know if it's for Mr. Kalani Senesi or his students. Is it Maui Community College where you get certified to be a hale builder?
University of Hawaii, Maui.
University system.
Oh, university system, okay. So when the AG is concerned, we could reference the University of Hawaii as a curriculum to certify. Yes.
Right now we're doing it at Windward Community College.
Wonderful, okay, very good. Thank you. We're gonna move on then to the final measure, SB 3029. Linked to Department of Hawaiian Homelands. And yeah, for those that need to fly, I don't know, did Bo leave already?
Yeah.
Oh, shucks, sorry. At least he got a little bit in there. Is there any other from neighbor islands that have a plane to catch? Can I let them go first? Okay, if not, then we'll call up DHHL.
Aloha mai kakou, Chair Shimabukuro, Vice Chair English, Senator Inouye. Because there's a number of individuals that have taken time out of their day to come here and be a part of this hearing, we're just going to summarize our testimony. We're in strong support of this bill, and what we'd like to just acknowledge is the historic nature of this bill. For the first time in the history of the department, to have the opportunity or potential of having our administrative and operating expenses sufficiently funded from general funds. This will provide the opportunity for us to improve our services to our beneficiaries, but more importantly, it'll take away the reliance of DHHL on the funds that are generated by the trust and allow for those resources to be spent specifically on the beneficiaries, which is where it should be. We would ask respectfully, in line with Judge Castagnetti's order, if the committee would consider one amendment, and that is to allow for the ability to allocate $28 million in 2016's budget, 2016-2017's budget, but to be able to reimburse DHHL for the current year's expenditures for operating and administrative expenses up to $28.4 million that are spent out of DHHL's resources or its special interest funds. And with that, we're available for questions.
Okay, thank you. Next, we have Association of Hawaiian Civic Clubs in support. And we have Kalahui, Hawaii Pidal PAC, in support. Huakukalo, Hawaiian Homes Community Association, support. Hawaii Manoa Hawaiian Homes Association, support. Keaka Community Association, these are all in support. Support. Kalamaula, Mauka Homestead Association, Panaeva, Hawaiian Homelands Community Association, Kailapa Community Association, Kapa'akea Hawaiian Homestead Association, Muku Okeawe Homestead Alliance, Ka Farmers Hui, Ho'o Manapono LLC. Thank you.
All right. It's the one I was waiting for. Aloha, everybody. Yeah. Demont. Okay, Ho'o Manapono, I'm gonna submit that testimony, I stand on that. Because what we stand for, Ho'o Manapono, is about empowering our people. That's why you see me here testifying on a lot of different various bills, because I'm trying to give voice to the voiceless, because I was once one of those voiceless people. So I just wanted to also state that one of the other hats that I wear is that I'm a noble in the House of Nobles for the lawful Hawaiian government, and we like nothing more than to see the collapse of the state. It's just pretty cool, because we believe in our kingdom. But so in reference to that, I wanted to bring you guys back to the attention of why the state was created to begin with, how you guys was able to be created. And that was regarding the compact on the Article 12, Section 2, which the state agreed by its people that you're going to engage in this compact with the United States, and as a condition of the trust provisions of the United States regarding the Hawaiian homelands. And so, because I'm a Kanaka Mole and I am one of those native Hawaiians, a small N, as referred to, let me wait till you guys talk.
I have to chair another committee, so
no
I'm
problem.
Just making arrangements, and I'm asking if she's going to vote today so that I can come back to vote.
No problem.
And if not, then I can run the other committee that's waiting for me.
Shoots. Okay.
You can proceed.
Yeah. So, under the Hawaiian Homes Commission Act, you have to be a native Hawaiian, small N. That is 50% or more. So I qualify for that, yeah. And so under that, that tell you that I get an interest in this particular arrangement that you guys have with the United States. And so as a beneficiary, I have a right to demand that you folks abide by the contract that you guys made with the United States. You would not have been able to become a state of the union unless you agreed to the terms of this contract. And as a state, it's troubling that you would seek to circumvent the contract that you made with the United States to become a state by utilizing the court system, wasting the judicial economy of the court system to continue to fight something you know you're supposed to do anyway. And so I just ask that you folks take that into consideration, that what DHHL is requesting is not a handout. It was a requirement that you guys fulfill the fiduciary duties of the Department of Hawaiian Homelands Commission Act. And part of that, the kuleana, is taking care of the administrative costs. You know what I mean? Otherwise, they're going to have to take money from our money. They're going to pinch from us. When in actuality, you guys is the parent. You guys assume the parental duties of DHHL. I mean, Department of Hawaiian Homes Commission Act. So all I say is abide by the contract that you did. But on a good note, if you don't, that shows that there is tyranny in your own government, and for your own declaration of independence, when there's tyranny, the people can rise up and break them down. And if the people decide to do that, remember, lawful Hawaiian government is here to stand for our people in the kingdom. Aloha.
Thank you, Mr. Connors. Next, Oʻamo Ina Alakaʻi Aina. Support. Center for Hawaiian Sovereignty Studies in opposition. And then we have a long list of individuals all in support. Is there anyone that here that wants to testify? We almost have you folks line up. Gekko Joe.
Thank you again, Madam Chair. Frederick Valentine Ilipuna Tassel, son of Marie Kealaula Okalani Rose, daughter of Grace Albertina Kamaikui Kiuvai Pianaya. Her oldest son, Abraham, once sat at the director's position of the Hawaiian Homes. His daughter, Ilima, also sat at the position of director of Hawaiian Homes. My grandmother, Grace Kamaikui Kiuvai, came to the hospital to pick me up as an infant and took me on my journey of life. After the doctor said that I was going to die, with all of her wisdom, she took me to Waimanalo Homestead, Lot 14, Bell Street, when she was in the first increment on this island, Waimanalo, born and raised on Hawaiian homelands. And now I stand in full favor of that which is the responsibility of the state of Hawaii to fund the Department of Hawaiian Homes. One of the reasons why you need to do this, besides the fact that it is part of 5F and the Admissions Act, of all the departments in the state of Hawaii, there is more exempt positions in the Department of Hawaiian Homelands than all other departments put together. So you are taking positions that are exempt and placing them on Hawaiian Home staff, paying them with Hawaiian Home money to make sure that they do qualify for their retirement. Many of them have come from this legislative body over the years. And I can name a few, but I will not. However, as a result of that, staff needs to get paid. Another house doesn't go up. Another family is still waiting on the waiting list. According to the 5F and according to the compact that you made with the Department of the Interior, along with the United States of America, it is your fiduciary responsibility to fund Hawaiian Homes. I stand in full support of the measure. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And actually, we did get late testimony from Papakolea Community Development Corporation and Kapua Kili'ikoa Kama'i, who's also here. So did anybody, any of the individuals want to come up and testify? Homilani Shadell?
Aloha again.
Aloha.
Chair Shimabukuro and Member Inouye, thank you for this opportunity. My name is Homilani Shadell, beneficiary of the Hawaiian Homes Commissions Act, and I am blessed to live on homestead lands in Kapolei. I do solemnly swear that I will support and defend the Constitution of the United States and the Constitution of the State of Hawaii, and that I will faithfully discharge my duties to the best of my ability. That is the oath each member of both houses repeat on opening day of the legislature. The Constitution of the United States is the central instrument of American government and the supreme law of the land. And so too is the Constitution of the State of Hawaii. This bill acknowledges that the legislature has failed to uphold the Hawaii State Constitution, Article 16, Section 7, Article 12, Sections 1 and 2, and Section 101 of the Hawaiian Homes Commissions Act, as amended in 1920, for decades, which prompted plaintiffs in the Nelson case to file suit against the state and the Hawaiian Homes Commission. I find it ironic that legislatures are often referred to as lawmakers, that the bills passed by the legislature becomes law, and that the legislature expects the judicial arm of our government to implement and or enforce these laws. Yet, when the judicial arm of our state government holds the legislature responsible and accountable to the Constitution of our state, the legislature deems it appropriate to assert its own powers to circumvent the law. The leadership in both houses unilaterally determined the judiciary arm of our government overstepped its authority and directed the Attorney General to file a motion to appeal the court's decision on the Nelson case, and decided to secure the services of outside counsel without consulting its members within the required time frame, thereby violating their own rules. Language in the Constitution of the State of Hawaii, Article 12, Section 1, is concise and clear. The legislature shall make sufficient sums available for the administration and operating budget of the Department of Hawaiian Homelands. Why must the Department of Hawaiian Homelands, on behalf of its beneficiaries, have to beg for what is constitutionally and rightfully ours? Why? A'oli loa, a'oli pono. Those in both houses who continue to resist fulfilling the obligation of this legislature and the people of this state to the Department of Hawaiian Homelands and its beneficiaries need to go outside of this building and read the inscription on the state seal. Instead of perpetuating righteousness, they perpetuate indifference and immorality. It is blatantly clear that we Hawaiians have few supporters in this legislature, and the indignation we feel is justified. The legislature's political dissidence continues to plague our people. Legislatures who feel the passivity of our people supports their impropriety and disregard of the law have not faithfully discharged their duty to the beneficiaries of the Department of Hawaiian Homelands. While I don't understand why another law must be enacted to ensure that the legislature fulfills its responsibility to an existing law, I appreciate that the introducers of this bill
and its companion in the House faced challenges from their colleagues to uphold the oath they swore by introducing this bill. And by the way, I'm going to interject here that I am sorely disappointed in those who are in this body on both houses who have the cocoa, especially in the Senate, who didn't step forward. It took a Howley to introduce this bill. I don't know what goes on in the backgrounds, and quite frankly, I don't care. But as the Hawaiian Affairs Committee, I would expect that you would have the best interests of the committee that you chair, which is the Hawaiians. I strongly support language in the bill to include the legislature appropriate the amount ordered by the court for the Department of Hawaiian Homelands 2015-16 budget from general funds and dropping their appeal. In its current version, I support this bill with reservations. Primarily, what I would like to see is that Judge Castanetti awarded an amount. 28.4, I believe. That is the amount the department should receive for their 2015-2016 budget, not 2016-2017. It should start now. In closing, I want this committee to know that while there are 76 members in the legislature, there are hundreds of homestead leaders and volunteers across this state in partnership with the Department of Hawaiian Homelands, other agencies and organizations who work countless hours to serve our people. Some of us with little or no experience are building community or health centers. We respond to and help resolve individual issues, work on multiple community projects, attend countless meetings and workshops and trainings, and like today, we are here advocating for the very same beneficiaries you swore to serve. You need to stop the Department of Hawaiian Homelands from having to pay Peter, I'm sorry, from having to rob Peter to pay Paul to keep their doors open. And you can do this by annually appropriating sufficient funds for the administrative and operating budget so that they can focus on their goals, which is to increase delivery of homes and improve service to their beneficiaries. Mahalo for allowing me the opportunity to present my testimony.
Thank you very much, Ms. Chisholm.
Any questions?
Last questions at the end.
Okay, thank you.
Well, yeah, if you have written testimony, you can get it to our staff if you have anything in writing.
I submitted my written testimony. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Is there anyone else that wishes to speak?
Yes, Rachel.
Hello, I'm Rachel Kailianu. Thank you for allowing me for talk. Actually, Mazmi was trying to coach me behind there, and I was trying to get him to come up as an individual. I happened to be here the day that our governor presented his opening speech for the year. And like he said, the governor said, we must learn from the mistakes of the past so that when we need to work, our government needs to work to gain back the people's trust. So when did that trust ever leave if you was doing everything above board? Yeah? Open and transparency. Auntie was correct in everything she said. We watch all of our legislators here in America swear an oath. There's a lot of things that we didn't know throughout the years because sometimes we don't participate in that. If we, at school, we take care of the school part. We are on commission board. Department of Hawaiian Homelands, K1 Hawaiian Homes Commission Board. We want deputy director and director. Then we know by law or by what is put in that our governor has a say on that. Of late, we didn't realize that we also somehow lost as a beneficiary, in fact, our leasee versus the beneficiary. As a leasee, we kind of lost our power as the people behind this trust, because I always thought we get to vote for our commissioners, not they get appointed from here and there. So I understand what Auntie is saying and what Uncle is saying and everybody's saying. I am for this bill because, like my husband said, it is in our constitution, it is in our, that's the only way the state became the state. Yeah. And I like to always tell people, I always say for the betterment of the Hawaiian people, and then they stop right there. But they need to finish that sentence. As defined by the betterment of the Hawaiian, the Native Hawaiian people, as defined by the Homelands, Hawaiian Homelands Act. So if we're going to put that as part of the condition or the contract with the United States, then we need to cover that first. And like Auntie Wynn explained, it is there. So why are we asking again? But since we're asking again, and I thank you folks for even bringing them up, please tighten the language. It must be the language we're not getting. Yeah? The language in the bill has to say, you know what, we never take care of the first contract. And unless we, like, void all that and really have people liking that, you know, us guys, we fought our independence movement, so we would really love that for what you folks fight among yourself. Please tighten up your language. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Anyone else want to testify on SB 3029? Yes,
Chair, I do, and just to let you know, I need to, I chair transportation and energy, so I need to leave.
Okay.
Aloha, Chair Shima Bukuro. My name is Paula Ayla. My name is Paula Ayla. I'm submitting testimony in support of SB 3029 for the state to provide sufficient funds of more than $28 million to the Department of Hawaiian Homelands. I'll put out a disclaimer. I am an employee of the department, but in this testimony, I'm providing it in my personal capacity as a beneficiary of the Hawaiian Homes Commission. I was raised in Waimanalo Homestead and will be a third generation homesteader when I receive my lease from the department. On January 25th, 2016, Governor Ige spoke of truthfulness in his State of the State address relating to the Super Ferry. He said, quote, truthfulness, it begins with being truthful. We in government are obligated to be truthful, even when the truth is not easy or popular. When we live without truth, our actions fail to pass the test of time. Moreover, we tend to repeat our mistakes because we have not learned from them. He goes on to say, a few years ago, we saw the demise of the Super Ferry. Its failure has been attributed to environmental objections and a hostile court. But that is not exactly what happened, according to his statement. The fact is, the state failed to follow the law. When we tried a legal end run, it also failed. The point is, the state should have followed the law and done the right thing in the first place, end quote. I'll give credit to Lee Cataluna for reminding me to look at that statement in one of her articles recently. This same statement about truth resonates in the Nelson case. No doubt, living up to the truth and conducting oneself to be truthful is a tall order. But when the governor and the legislators, such as yourself, took an oath to uphold the Constitution of the State of Hawaii, the order got taller. The Nelson case is another example of the state's failure to follow the law over and over again since statehood, and became the compelling reason for the beneficiaries to sue the state. Not only has the state not allowed the law, but repeats, not followed the law, but repeats history by trying a legal end run by asking Judge Castagnetti to reconsider her November 2015 decision. The state's position regarding jurisdiction, in my opinion, is an afterfact in that we wouldn't be talking about jurisdiction had the state followed their constitutional obligation to sufficiently fund the department. The state has wasted a lot of time and taxpayer dollars on this case when, in fact, they should have been truthful from the beginning, as Governor Ige stated, due to the compact of statehood to fully and sufficiently fund the department. So I agree with the governor and his statement. Quote, the state should have followed the law and done the right thing in the first place, end quote. So I say to the governor and legislators such as yourself to live up to your obligation and your oath of office and to fund the Department of Hawaiian Homelands more than $28 million and now, not to wait. You can be truthful and you have the opportunity to do that by appropriating the funds today. Do not repeat your mistakes. We are first in line for funding. Mahalo.
Thank you very much. Anyone else want to testify on this measure? Okay. Lord Kapua, yes, please.
I want to take a moment to stand here, and hopefully the camera is reading this. And so what my shirt says is to fund Hawaiian homelands now. So camera, I hope you're looking at it.
Very good.
And, you know, it's sad that our department had to take money out of their funding, or however they were able to gather the money to sponsor this. But I retract that statement. We had a leadership meeting. So it was appropriate for the leaders to know why we were called together and to know, to be reminded of our kuleana, to our ohana, and the extended Hawaiian ohana that we all represent. And I speak more so for those 27,000 plus beneficiaries that are on the wait list, not for us 9,000 that currently have homes. You know, I am a proud lessee from Waianae Valley Homestead, but for too long, the legislatures from this body has denied their kuleana. And like the previous speakers, testifiers have said, I agree and support all of their mana'oan, you know. It's just sad. It's sad, you know, when the governor was talking about the homeless people, and it's like, yeah, we have 27,000 Hawaiians that could fit into that category if we didn't double up and triple up in our homes. And I'm not just speaking for those that are on Hawaiian homelands, for wherever the people are. And these are the people of the land, not the people that came here for a better life. But this is for the people that opened their doors initially, and then subsequently, not only was the door broken down, so were all of the walls. Everything was just gutted and replaced. That's what happened when America took over. So I'm proud to say that we're at a time and place in our history to where we are trying to make it right. But it's not the Hawaiian way to kick everybody out just because we're upset. It's our way to try and work it out, to work it through. And so it's been disappointing that, as the previous speakers have said, that we've had to remind the legislators of their kuleana. So in my testimony, I ask that we stop with the legal cases, wasting the money, wasting the resources, wasting the time, and fulfill your kuleana of funding the Department of Hawaiian Homelands what is appropriate. And the judiciary said a minimum of $28 million. Which means nothing less, nothing less. And as the previous speakers have said, It should start this year, not waiting till next year, but should start this year. And so it is sad to say that we don't all agree, but we do have to know what is your moral responsibility and what is right, what is justice. So I thank you for holding this, and I hope that when you call your committee members that they return so that we can all have some resolution. But more so, once this money, anticipating the money to be appropriated as it should be, I hold the governor accountable for releasing that money. Because often, too many times, the legislature appropriates funds, they pass bills, and now we have to wait for the governor to release the funding. Immediately release the funding when he signs the bill. Mahalo.
Mahalo, Kapua. Is there anyone else that wishes to testify? Yes. Puni. Good to see you.
Okay. Good afternoon. Aloha. For the record, my name is Puni Kekau'oha, and I stand on the testimony that I've submitted yesterday. And I'm really here on behalf of my ohana. As you know, I have served the Papakulea community for 25 years. But this afternoon, I feel a special push to come and talk to you on behalf of the children and the future generations of Hawaiian Homestead beneficiaries, two of which are my grandchildren. And, you know, having done the work of community work for this many years, I definitely have worked hand in hand with the department on behalf of the people in Papakulea, and we've been successful in many things. But one of the things that we constantly find ourselves at challenge with is a need for resources to fix infrastructure that's very old. And this bill, you know, when you support, and we ask you, of course, to support this bill. For so many years, the department has had to use trust funds in order to take care of their admin and op costs. And it's taken away from homesteads like Papakulea, Nanakuli, Wamanalo, the older homesteads that need repair. We need help. And so I ask on behalf of the children, because we don't want to leave them with systems that are broken. They need to be repaired. So I come to you to ask, you know, on behalf of the children, do what is right. Give them the resources they need out of the state's general fund in the amount as articulated by Judge Castanetti now. Now. Give them the $28 million. They need more. We know they need more. But please support this bill. Give them the money that is constitutionally your kuleana as a body. We, as homestead leaders, we've seen this for too long. We fight, you know, with the department. We go at it, you know, tooth and nail. And it's not right that we have to constantly go at it with them. Because at the end of the day, it's really not their call. It's the kuleana of this house. So, you know, we ask you, because I seen a couple weeks ago, you know, one of the few times that Hawaiian Homestead leaders came hand in hand and united strong with the Department of Hawaiian Homelands to come together with them to advocate strongly for the state legislature to support the Nelson ruling. So, you know, with a lot of passion and aloha for the Department of Hawaiian Homelands, but more so for the future generations of Hawaiian Homeland beneficiaries, I humbly ask you and this body to please support Senate Bill 3029.
Thank you very
much. Aloha. Mahalo.
Thank you, Puni. You had one? Yes.
Hi. This is a late testimony.
No problem.
I couldn't have said it better.
Could you speak to the mic? It's been a little.
I couldn't have said it better than the community here this afternoon. And I'm in support of everything that they have to say. So I stand here in support of Senator Bill Senate Bill 3029, and it addresses the legislature as it fulfills and complies with the court and state constitution, the Admissions Act, as legislators under oath to appropriate the sufficient general funds for administrations and operating expenses for Department of Hawaiian Homelands for the fiscal year of 2016 and 2017.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Anyone else want to testify? Okay, yes, Garnett.
Hi, I am in full support of this bill. However, after the legislature and the governor awards Hawaiian Homelands their $28.4 million, I also want to ensure that for every fiscal year, we get at least 20% of the general funding from the state. That's it. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, any other testifiers? No, okay, we're going to recess. Or I guess, no, not recess. No, okay. Homelania, I know, is from my district too. So yeah, don't be. Oh, perfect. Thank you. We're going to two measures that were deferred today. We're going to start with the deferred measures at 28. Yeah, so for SB 2868 relating to qualification for successors on DHHL lands, the recommendation is to pass an SD1 with amendments. And it's technical amendments that SMA recommends.
Okay, Chair's recommendation is to pass Senate Bill 2868 with amendments. Chair Shimabukuro?
Aye.
I vote aye. Senator Inouye?
Aye.
Senator Kim?
Aye.
Senator Sloan is excused. Measures adopted.
Thank you very much. SB 2994 relating to Hawaiian Homes. This is the one about the independent counsel for DHHL. This would also pass an SD1 with amendments. And again, technical amendments recommended by SMA.
Chair's recommendation is to pass Senate Bill 2994 with amendments. Of the members present, any noes? Any reservations? Measures adopted.
Thank you very much. Now going to today's agenda, SB 2730 relating to Anahola Hawaiian Homes Association. I'm going to recommend we pass as is, but in the committee report, I do want to note the concerns raised by Ho'omano Pono LLC and Uncle Joe Tassel about, you know, some of the concerns they have about some of the what's going on there and some of the disagreements that are happening. And just to, you know, to point that out, that it was raised, and hopefully it's something that can be addressed as we move along with this bill.
So you're going to have a minute.
As is, but just committee report reflecting that.
Okay. Chair's recommendation is to pass Senate Bill 2730 as unamended. Of the members present, any noes, any reservations? Measures adopted.
Thank you. SB 2762, relating to Kamehameha Celebration. Recommendation is to pass as is.
Chair's recommendation is to pass Senate Bill 2762 as is. Any opposition of the members present? Any reservations? Measures adopted.
Thank you. SB 2763, relating to King Kamehameha Celebration as well. Recommend to pass as is.
Chair's recommendation is to pass 2763 unamended. Of the members present, any noes? Any reservations? Measures adopted.
Thank you. SB 2806, also relating to King Kamehameha Celebration Commission. Recommendation is to pass with amendments, this one, SD1, with technical amendments recommended by SMA.
Chair's recommendation is to pass Senate Bill 2806 with amendments. Of the members present, any noes, any reservations? Measures adopted.
Thank you. SB 2946, relating to Indigenous Hawaiian Architecture on Ag Land. With this measure, I would recommend an SD1 with amendments. To take Department of Ag's amendments, where they wanted to make sure it was limited to the ag district land and to structures that are accessory to agricultural activities. We could have discussion too, but that was what the ag, for this specific bill, wanted to make sure that we're talking about ag lands and ag structures. I also wanted to note in section one, the purpose clause, especially since DPP testified that they've already done an Indigenous Architecture Code and it's not necessary. I want to point out Act 222, Senator English's bill from 2007, which was SB 1917, This bill specifically legalized indigenous architecture for residential purposes, and it gave the counties 1 year to come up with a building code to allow for that to happen. And we, you know, we applaud that the counties have done it for non-residential, and but we do, to our knowledge, they have not done the same for residential holly. And so we want to just point that out in section one, that that's why we're pushing for this bill. And the committee report, I think, That's section one. That's it. Those amendments to SD 2946.
Okay, I just want to...
Discussion.
Yeah, I was going to note that... I'm okay with passing this out. There was maybe some other fine-tuning, but we can do that in the Ways and Means Committee.
You sure? There's anything?
Yeah. No, I think it's good because we're running out of time. So
yeah, okay, that's what I figured.
Let's just move it to the second committee.
Sure.
All right. So Chair's recommendation is to pass with amendments. Senate Bill 3059.
Hold on, sorry, it's 2946.
Yep, 2946. Of the members present, any noes, any reservations? Okay, measures adopted.
Thank you. SB 3059 relates to indigenous architecture. With this measure, this is the one that pretty much deregulates indigenous architecture. I do want to add a definition of indigenous architecture that was, I think they have it in the building code, and we can find out. SMA said they can find a definition of indigenous architecture. I also want to define who are holly builders and how they become certified, since that was AG raised that. And note that University of Hawaii does have a course in this at Maui Community College and Windward Community College. And so there is an established program to certify these holly builders. We would like to see it expanded. I'll take the recommendation of DLNR. Their second to last paragraph, their testimony, they said they want to make sure that this bill doesn't conflict with anything of their duties to maintain safety and health and safety. It's kind of a general thing. And then again, in section one, the rationale, I want to point out Act 222, as I stated earlier with the previous bill. Any other suggestions for amendments?
Okay. Chair's recommendation is to pass Senate Bill
3059. I need technical amendments as well for both.
3059 with amendments of the members present. Any noes, any reservations? Okay, measures adopted.
SB 3029 related to DHHL. For this bill, my understanding of the protocol of these committees is that we typically zero out the amounts in appropriation measures. However, and we leave it to the purview of Ways and Means to actually put those amounts in. However, I would like to note in the committee report, which indicates our committee's intent, the testimony of DHHL and others that asked that the bill reflect the judge's ruling, that we talk about not only. We were talking about this current fiscal year as well as the next fiscal year. Mm-hmm. And that DHHL is to be reimbursed for those trust funds that they've spent in this fiscal year to bring it to the
PMO. Chair, I'd also like noted in the committee report our concern of separation of powers and the legislature's sovereignty over these particular issues.
But you know, it's only tradition that we've done. Taking out the dollar bill, I'd like to put the amount in. Yeah?
No, it's taken out.
Okay.
But yeah, it's kind of the protocol as far as I've seen it.
Discussion point, the fact that there is a concern that we do have the jurisdiction to put in to the committee report what the ruling is, I don't might be in conflict with each other. I mean, we're acknowledging it. On the other hand, we're saying, well, but that's our kuleana, so
how do we take vote on?
I don't see the problem within the committee report stating that that's what the testifiers asked for.
Okay. Oh, I see. Okay. What the testifiers asked for. Okay. I thought you meant to insert the court's thing in there.
DHHL and others testified that they were asking that, and I just wanted to make a comment to all of you, and I appreciate so much those of you that came out today, because as some of you may or may not know, the next committee is Ways and Means, and that committee on the Senate side, they do not take any oral testimony. Written testimony is allowed, but no oral, unless they have questions, which they may ask of DHHL. So, you know, you may feel like it was just me sitting here, you know, how come? But it was on Olelo, it was on Capitol broadcast, and these hearings are monitored by Ways and Means staff and finance staff as well on that side. And so the fact that you spoke you know, what you felt is very important, because when it goes down to Ways and Means, they, like I said, typically do not take oral testimony. So thank you to those that took the time to share your manao.
Regarding
we're in the middle of a vote.
Yeah, we're okay, maybe we should vote. I'll talk to you after.
Okay, so the chair's recommendation is to pass Senate Bill 3029 with amendments of the members present.
Are you going to include their recommendation
in the committee?
She had,
In the middle of a vote of the members objecting or with reservation, if not, matter passes 1, 2, 3, 4.
Okay, all right, so we are adjourned, and I can take any kind of questions now. I'm